Right. With that, I think we can just start the session. I welcome you all to the second session of West 2022. My name is Michael Woloch. I'm an independent postdoc in the Quantum Materials Modeling Group of the University of Vienna. And together with Martina and Norbert, I'm the organizer of West this year. And I will be chairing this seminar today. You might not see me as large as you would hope in your window. You're seeing Martina right now, I think. That's because I'm also streaming the sessions on YouTube and organizing that. But I think you can live with that, not seeing me full screen. I hope so. So maybe Martina and Norbert, my co-organizers, can quickly introduce themselves for those who did not see the first session. So just a couple of words, please, from you two.
Hello, everyone. For whom wasn't attending last session, my name is Martina Stella. I am a Boltzmann Research Fellow at ICTP, and I work mainly on developing DFT methods for excited states and sometimes tool tribology. And I welcome you all to this second session of West. I hope you enjoy the great talks we have upcoming.
Yes, hello from my side as well. My name is Norbert Bader. I am currently postdoc at the IMKT Leibniz University of Hanover, studying EHL contacts mainly. And I also welcome you and hope that today's session will be as exciting as our first session.
So, then I want to say that this year's topic of the seminar series is tribology applications of big data, high throughput machine learning and artificial intelligence. Which you probably already know. And we have in total 3 days of seminar. This is the second day, and the last one will be upcoming Friday, October the 14th. And the format, if you don't remember, is we have two invited speakers for each session, and then three flash talks in the middle. And without much further ado, I want to introduce the first invited speaker today, which is Professor Maria Clelia Righi from the University of Bologna. As I said, she's a full professor at the Department of Physics and Astronomy at the Bologna University since 2020, after winning an ERC Consolidator Grant for Advancing Solid Interfaces and Lubricants by First Principle Materials Design, or SLIDE, which is a very nice acronym. Before that, she was a professor at the University of Modena in Reggio Emilia since 2016, and I had the great pleasure of working with her there as a postdoc from 2017 to 2019. She is also a visiting professor at Imperial College London and collaborates with different multinational companies, for example, Total and Toyota. And she's on the number of editorial boards and has given a numerous invited talks, for example, at the Gordon Conference, the MRS Spring Meeting, and maybe most important of all, at West before this one. So Clelia is renowned for her pioneering work in ab initio tribology and also cryochemistry. And I know for a fact, because I worked with her on it, that she has been interested in high throughput methods for some time. So her work is an excellent fit for this year's topic. And yeah, her presentation will be entitled High Throughput Screening of Adhesive Friction in Solid-Solid Interfaces. And with that, I invite you to share the screen, Clelia, and start your presentation.
Okay, let me share the screen. Okay. Can you see my screen?
Yes, I think we can.
Okay. So thank you very much. Nice introduction. And so I am going to present the results of a work on high throughput calculation, as you mentioned, that was started also in your collaboration. So I'm very happy to present in this conference that you organized. So you know very well that integrating experimental tools with computational experiments with computational tools and digital data is nowadays considered a key strategy to reduce the time and costs for materials discovery and deployment. In this context, high throughput calculations based on solving the fundamental equation of the Schrödinger equation for the many body system for many materials in parallel in a relatively short time is considered requiring very importance in this context, and they have been successfully applied to improve and also discover new materials for several applications. I would like to use the pointer. Let me see if I can. Can you see my cursor or should
Claudia,
I?
I see your presentation not in full screen.
Ah, really?
It's just my problem. I'm not sure.
Ah, thank you, Martina. Let me disconnect from the. We tried previously.
Yeah, now it's okay. Now it works. Now it's fine.
Okay. Thank you for. Giving me the possibility to change. Okay, so this is the idea of high throughput calculation, and they have been applied successfully for designing materials for many applications, from hydrogen storage to catalysis. And what we want to do is to apply high throughput screening of solid interfaces. This in particular for tribological applications. So this is one of the aims of the ERC project line that you mentioned. So we have started this project even before my ERC started. We developed an initial workflow. Sorry. Okay. First of all, introduced a protocol to derive two important tribologic. Can you see me?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So first of all, I introduced a protocol to calculate two very important figures of merit in tribology by first principle calculations. The work of adhesion that is defined by as the energy required to separate two surfaces from contact, and the ideal shear strength, that is the maximum resistance to sliding of an ideal interface. This can be calculated, first of all, by calculating the adhesion energy as a function of the relative lateral position of the two surfaces, thus constructing what is called the potential energy surface or gamma surface of the interface that describes how the adhesion changes as a function of the relative position. And these energy variations give rise to frictional forces. Indeed, by selecting a potential profile along a specific direction and deriving it, it's possible to monitor the forces that are present when during the sliding motion. And we consider the most negative force divided by the area as the ideal shear strength. So the maximum shear strength that the interface can resist before start sliding. So the most relevant path among the different possible paths is the minimum energy path that connects the path minima passing through the saddle points. And this path can be automatically identified by different methods. We consider the zero temperature string method and implemented it in our first version of the workflow. That was composed by four different units. There was, first of all, a set of very limited number of input parameters is red. Then there is a bulk unit where the bulk properties of the elemental system considered are calculated, and the computational parameters are optimized automatically. So the optimal kinetic energy cutoff, the optimal K-point density are identified by using the Monaghan equation of states to describe the bulk that allows also to calculate the theoretical lattice parameter and bulk modulus. Then the surface properties are calculated. In particular, the surface energy is obtained and the thickness of the slab that is used to model the surface is automatically optimized by converging the calculated surface energy. And then the interface is automatically constructed, and tribological properties as the adhesion and the shear strength, but also electronic properties such as the electronic charge displacement that I will describe later, are automatically computed. So we apply this workflow, first of all, to study the properties of homogeneous interfaces that are interfaces like iron on iron obtained by mating two equivalent bulk materials. We, for each material, we consider different possible surface orientation. In this table, I'm reporting just the most stable values, the value of the adhesion for the surface that turned out to be more stable. So on the left, I report the adhesion energy, and on the right, the corresponding ideal shear strength. So you can see that the color code, where the darker color indicates higher adhesion, immediately reveals that transition metals where the d orbitals are not fully occupied have the highest adhesion. And this is also reflected in the shear strength. So immediately we realize that there should be a correlation between the two the quantities. And so we calculated the cleavage strength, that is the maximum resistance to cleavage of the two surfaces, the function of the adhesion, and the shear strength is a function of adhesion. And we found that there is a linear correlation between the first two quantities, as one could have imagined, while the relation between the adhesion and the shear strength is a power law that we identify in this way. So this analysis allows us to calculate the shear strength of an interface by knowing just its adhesion, which is much more easily calculated than the wall potential energy surface and the shear strength. But the analysis of the data are also relevant to understand the mechanical properties of materials. For example, here I have reported the ratio between the ideal shear strength and the cleavage strength. And you can easily understand that when this ratio is high, that means that the failure mode of the material will be a brittle cleavage, because it's very difficult to shear while it's more easy to cleavage. While the opposite situation of low values of this ratio indicates a ductile failure, because it's easier to create a stacking fault and to nucleate a dislocation instead of a crack. So you can understand that by analyzing the database obtained by means of high throughput calculations, these general relations can be identified. These are just some few examples, but relevant because these parameters can also be used in macro scale models, where very often the materials properties related to the microscopic details are not taken into account, and parameters such as the adhesion, the ideal shear strength, are empirical or just qualitative description. We then studied the relation between the interfacial properties, tribological properties, and electronic properties to understand the fundamental origin of the adhesion and the shear strength. In particular, we analyzed the electronic charge distribution. On the left, you see the planar average of the electronic charge distribution along the direction perpendicular to the interface. I'm considering an iron bulk that is obtained by mating two iron surfaces here represented. Can you see my cursor?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So you can see that when mating two surfaces, a redistribution of the electronic charge occurs because this spilling off of the charge is removed and a charge is accumulated at the middle of the interface. So this electronic charge redistribution can be calculated precisely in the same way as the adhesion energy is calculated. That is, by subtracting from the total electronic charge of the interface the electronic charge of the two separated surfaces. And so here there is a representation of this charge redistribution, and we define its integral in the interfacial region of the absolute value of this difference as the total amount of charge that is redistributed when an interface is formed. And we found that this amount of charge that is redistributed, that is mainly accumulated at the middle of the interface, has a linear correlation with adhesion. And this holds true for different interactions. We found this for layer materials, for metallic materials, and for covalent materials. And so the adhesion is dictated by the amount of charge that is accumulated at the interface when the interface is formed, basically. And this understanding is very useful to design specific surface chemical modifications to prevent this charge flow from the bulk to the interface. For example, if we cover an iron surface with sulfur atoms, and we mate it with a clean iron surface, we can see that the charge distribution is much lower. This scale from 0 to 10 is lower than this one, that the charge distribution that occurs for clean iron. And the adhesion is reduced is highly reduced, and this reduction reaches one order of magnitude when we cover the two iron surfaces by graphene, and also the charge accumulation at the middle of the interface is highly reduced. The same holds, for example, for diamond on diamond has a very high adhesion, while hydrogenated diamond as a very the adhesion decreases almost by two order of magnitudes, and this is because the charge that can accumulate in the interface is much lower than in clean diamond. So this fundamental understanding is important to design, for example, lubricant materials that are necessary to reduce friction in sliding contact. Indeed, we discovered that this electronic charge distribution is connected not only with the adhesion, but also with the frictional forces, because we analyzed the amount of charge that is present in the interface when the two surfaces are stacked in such a way that we have a minimum in the potential energy surface. This amount of charge is higher than the amount of charge that is at the interface when the surfaces are on a maxima of the potential energy surface. So when a slider moves on a substrate, there is a charge redistribution during sliding, and this charge redistribution dictates the appearance and the magnitude of the frictional forces, because this is the origin of this minima and this maxima. And as I explained before, this feature of the potential energy surface are directly related to the shear strength. Okay. Then after considering the homogeneous interfaces, we consider heterogeneous interfaces that are obtained by mating two different crystals. And for example, here I'm representing copper on iron. And as you can understand, the situation becomes much more difficult, because we have to mate two different crystal lattices. And the calculation can become very computational demanding if we want to minimize the mismatch between the two mated surfaces. In order to define a common supercell for the two lattices, we adopted the Zur algorithm that was developed in the past and was implemented in a library that we included in our workflow with some modification. That is the MPI interface library. And this algorithm allows to identify the supercell, the common supercell to the two different lattices, once a threshold value for the mismatch is identified, is provided. So in our workflow, we select a threshold value for the acceptable mismatch, and then the Zur algorithm automatically identify the minimum supercell area, in plane area, that can accommodate the two lattices with that given mismatch threshold. For example, here in black, you can see the supercell that has been identified for this couple of lattices. So the lattices are automatically rotated, for example, one with respect to the other, to obtain the minimum size for the common supercell. And once this supercell is identified, our workflow is able to calculate the PES, the potential energy surface, for the hetero interface. This is done by identifying the high symmetry points of each lattice. For example, here I'm representing copper on aluminum. So we have this common supercell, this is this rectangular cell, where the high symmetry points of each lattice are indicated. And when the two surfaces are mated, the energy is calculated for every couple of symmetry points. So by shifting the on top side, on the hollow side of the second surface, on the top side of the second surface, so all the possible pairs are considered and replicated within the common supercell. And this allows us to obtain the potential energy surface for the heterogeneous interface. So all this has been implemented in a very advanced computational code based on Python, which is composed by three main units. We have a computational kernel where the input-output handling, when considering the most used software packages for materials science, such as VASP, Quantum Espresso, LAMPS, are constructed, automatically constructed. Here, the Pipeman Gen and MPI interfaces are used. Indeed, the surface interface are automatically calculated, as well as the tribological and the electronic properties that I described before. There is a high throughput unit that is based on the Fireworks library that allows to create, manipulate, and execute complex workflows. And finally, there is a navigator that is that manages the interaction with the database. So the reading from open database and storing the data, and this is a very delicate part of this machinery. So we devoted a lot of effort in developing this navigator for managing the data and also the provenance of the data. Okay, so we applied this software to calculate the addition of heterogeneous interfaces. We started by considering metals because they are technologically relevant. Indeed, the results that we obtained can be used also to understand not only tribological properties of materials, but they can also provide some insights in metallurgy, because they provide information such as the solid solubility of a material when an alloy is formed from two different metals. So you can see that we reported on this diagonal of this table the energies of the homogeneous interfaces that correspond to double the surface energy of these materials. And so you can easily observe that, as noticed before, we have higher values for the addition when transition metals have partially occupied the orbitals, while when the orbitals become occupied, such as in the noble metals, the addition decreases. And the addition of heterogeneous interfaces is somehow a mixture of this behavior, okay? So it's also possible to understand this by simply observing this color code. So first of all, this is an interesting result, the fact per se that we have provided these numerical values for the addition, because up to now, it was not possible to find in textbooks a systematic description of the addition of material space. What we found is just a qualitative description proposed by Rabinovich, who described this quantity, the compatibility of two different metals by considering the solid solubility that can be measured in the experiment. So the material pairs that are defined compatible are those that have a solid solubility higher than 1%. Partially compatible, those that have the solid solubility in this range, and so on. So by defining this compatibility, guess on the addition energy, according to this author, could be proposed by this simple relation between this compatibility and the surface energy of the two metals. So as you can understand, this is just a qualitative description. So having accurate values, because again, we are performing first principle calculations, so we are able to describe accurately the chemical interactions at the interface, is something that can be useful for also engineering models, macro scale models. And but the idea of describing the adhesion in terms of the properties of each material is very interesting. I will come later on this issue. We analyzed if the relation that we found for homogeneous interfaces between the charge displacement and the adhesion energy holds true also for heterogeneous interface. And this is the case, as you can immediately notice by comparing these two graphs, where we reported again the adhesion energies and the calculated charge displacement as described by this formula. And this is also visible in this plot where the correlation index is 0.75. So these results confirm that the adhesion of heterogeneous interface is directly correlated by the amount of charge that is accumulated in the interface when the two surfaces are mated, as it happened for homogeneous interfaces. As I said, it's interesting to find to identify a relation between the adhesion and that is an interfacial property with the property of the single materials that are paired. So as you probably know, this is the expression that relates the interface energy, gamma 1-2, with the surface energies. So it's clear that where the interface energy basically is the energy cost or gain to pass from an elemental bulk to an interface. So to remove bulk bonds and create interfacial bonds in analogy with the definition of surface energy, that is the energy cost in this case to create a surface, that is to remove completely the bulk bonds on the surface. So it has been suggested in this book by Israel Achbili, that the interfacial energy, the interface energy, which is not possible to directly measure, can be related to the surface energies in this way. So by substituting this in the expression for the adhesion, we obtain that the adhesion should be equal to the geometric average of the surface energies. So this is something that we immediately try to check, to verify. And indeed, by plotting the adhesion as a function of the geometric average of our ab initio data, we found a good correlation, 0.8, the correlation, and the root mean square error, that's 0.57. So this suggests that indeed the adhesion could be calculated once the surface energies are known, and these are typically known also for experiments. But we wanted to see if something better could be obtained by applying machine learning. So we adopted the SUR independent screening and sparsifying operator, the acronym is CISO, that allows to extract effective material descriptor out of a large number of possible correlated features of a materials. And it also allows to identify the relationship between the wanted properties, such as the adhesion energy and the descriptors in terms of an analytical equation. So both the analytical equation and the descriptors are identified. So it's very smart, this algorithm. So we consider different possible descriptors describing the properties of the two separated surfaces, because as I said, we would like to provide a prescription to calculate the adhesion just from the properties of the two separated materials. So we consider the cohesive energies, the bulk modulus, again, the surface energies, the atom density at the surface, the difference in the electronegativity of the two elements, and the, both the arithmetic average and the geometric average of all these parameters. So we had a list of almost 20 parameters, and thanks to the CISO algorithm, we could identify, first of all, that just three are the relevant parameters: the geometric average of the surface energies, the geometric average of the cohesive energies, and the geometric average of the bulk modulus. The other descriptors are less relevant. Indeed, what we found, including the other description, were very similar to what we found just considering this trip. So, because it is already embedded in, for example, the difference between the surface energy and the cohesive energy, the information on the atomic densities, the geometry, and also in the bulk modulus, the possibility of the two surfaces to adapt each other. So we and the algorithm proposed different analytical expressions of increasing complexity that we call phi zero, phi one, phi two. But yeah, the correlation index was already very satisfactory for a linear correlation that we prefer, because we can also provide a physical meaning to this expression, because it's clear that the adhesion energy increases as the surface energies, indeed the coefficient is negative because we define the adhesion as the energy gain, and also it's proportional to the cohesive energies, but it's while the bulk modulus is provide a positive contribution, because as harder are the two materials in contact and as more difficult they can adapt to decrease their interfacial energy. But this the coefficient is very small in comparison to the other two, where the surface energy dominate. So this is an example of what can be done when database are constructed, and this is what we are also trying to do by considering chemical modifications of our surfaces, because in the past we found that by modifying chemically the two surfaces in contact, the adhesion can be really tuned. For example, we found that by covering the two iron surfaces with 1/4 of monolayer of phosphorus, the adhesion of iron decreases to half of its value. And by including the same quantity amount of sulfur atoms, the this decrease is of 1 order of magnitude. So the idea is that to try to perform a high throughput screening of possible adsorbates on our metal surfaces, and to identify their effect on the adhesion energy, because in some cases one could also desire to increase the adhesion of an interface. So we consider the metal interfaces that I presented before, and calculated the chemisorption of these elements of the first two periods, the non-metal elements of the first two periods, and also sulfur and phosphorus that are key elements for lubricant additives. So first of all, we identified the most favorable absorption site for these atoms by absorbing the atom in the high symmetry sites of the different considered surfaces. Then we calculated the adhesion as a function of the coverage and analyzing the chemisorption energy as a function of coverage. And finally, by mating the two covered surfaces with the selected atoms, we calculate the adhesion of the new interface and its percentual decrease or increase with respect to the clean interface. So here I report the absorption energies in EV per atom. For the atomic species that I mentioned and for all the metals that we have studied before, at 25% coverage. And in yellow is the corresponding equilibrium distance obtained after the relaxation. So you can see that there are, yes, atomic species that present very high absorption energy, like carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, on especially on transition metals that have the orbitals partially occupied. And a corresponding trend in the absorption distances can be observed. So again, with this high throughput screening, it's possible to, yes, obtain the, here, this is an ongoing study, so we have not yet analyzed through machine learning algorithm or general trends, but again, just with the color code that is possible to identify some relation, some correlation. We also, in this plot, reported the adhesion energy as a function of coverage. We consider 25, 50, and 100% coverage. And we found that for almost all the absorbed species, the adhesion energy decreases as a function of coverage, as can be understood by analyzing the energy, the interaction energy between the absorbed atom that can be easily calculated by just considering the monolayer of absorbed atoms and comparing the energy per atom with the energy of the isolated atom. And we can see that apart from the very small atoms, the other atoms start to create bonds among them, increasing the coverage. And so by increasing the atom-atom interaction, we have a slight decrease of the atom-substrate interaction, resulting in a higher an increase of the absorption distance and a corresponding decrease of the adhesion energy, the absorption energy. Finally, we calculate the reduction, adhesion reduction or percentage increase with respect to the adhesion of the clean metal. In this case, I'm just considering a 50% coverage. Other calculations are ongoing. And it's interesting to see that there are some elements, like, for example, sulfur, that reduces the adhesion for almost all the metals considered. And this is relevant because we know that sulfur is a key element for lubricant additives. So this kind of analysis is useful to design also lubricant additives, lubricant materials. While other elements like, for example, carbon and boron, instead increase the adhesion between the couple of metals considered. So if one has to increase the adhesion, for example, of a coating on a substrate or to design an alloy with specific characteristics, this information can be useful, not just for understanding the frictional properties, but also to understand the nature of the metal-metal interaction that can be also modified by some impurities. In conclusion, I've shown you that we developed an advanced software for performing high throughput calculations of solid interfaces. And we applied it to the Scribe, first of all, homogeneous interfaces, identifying general trends and also providing the fundamental understanding on the origin of friction, for example, the relation between the interfacial properties and electronic properties. We have extended this method to heterogeneous interfaces that are more relevant for applications. And we have populated a database for metals and also applied machine learning algorithm to be able to describe this interfacial property, the adhesion, in terms of the bulk properties and surface energy of the two separated elements. And finally, we are extending this machinery to screen how chemical surface modifications can affect adhesion. I would like to thank my collaborators that are presently working on this issue, Paolo Restuccia, Margherita Marsili, and Michele Cutini, and of course, those who contributed previously to the development of the workflow, Omar Keimani, Gabriele Losi, and Michael Wallock. And I would like also to thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Clelia, for this excellent talk, for being perfect in time as well. Very nice. And with that, I want to ask the panel first, maybe, for some questions. So if we have some of the other speakers from today that want to ask some questions. Otherwise, I have a lot, of course. Because I don't think we see anything in the chat yet. So maybe
no,
I start.
No, I'm checking, and there's nothing yet, but I'm asking again.
Okay, maybe I start then. Clelia, basically one of the last things you showed is really stark difference that you see on some of the elements for the that you intercalate between the surfaces in respect to adhesion. Have you looked in if it is just could be or some part of it could be the size of the ions? So just geometric, basically. Okay, he pushes it further apart, so the adhesion goes down.
Yes, this is related to the size of the ions. For example, I'm not able to go back. Also in the past, when we tried to study the effect of adhesion reduction in iron, we compared on the same row oxygen, sulfur, and then also selenium, that is has a larger radius than sulfur, and we found a perfect trend with the atomic radius in that case. Here it seems again that we have similar trends. We have not yet performed a quantitative analysis, but as we did for iron, as I said. Yes, in that case, it was clear that there is a higher Pauli repulsion when the atomic radius is increased, because especially at high coverage, the Pauli repulsion among the passivated surfaces is higher when the size of the atom is higher, because there is a higher overlap of the fully occupied atomic orbitals, let's say in this picture. So it's clear that the metal-metal interaction is better screened for higher atomic radius than for smaller one when the separation between the surface is also not enough to prevent a direct metal-metal contact, for example, as it happened in the case of hydrogen or even carbon or boron that have lower atomic radius and are less effective in screening the metal-metal interactions.
Okay, yeah, makes a lot of sense. So, still no questions in the chat, I think. We actually saw that a lot of people do ask, do watch these videos later on demand. So the
Yes.
views go up a lot. So I will try to ask one more question. Maybe it's interesting to the future audience as well, and that is more of a technical question maybe, because you showed that these you have this quite impressive collection of software for doing these high throughput studies and to create these databases. And do you, I mean, you also mentioned LAMMPS and Quantum Espresso. I mean, these calculations I think have been done with WASP, if I'm correct.
Yes,
Yeah,
yes.
but I mean, I know that some of these codes can expect multiple or can use multiple calculators, let's say. But it's I think it was this very hard to implement, let's say, to use, for example, LAMMPS as well for. Or is it possible, to example, to do some pre-relaxation with LAMMPS and then switch to WASP or Quantum Espresso for more, let's say, for the final optimization?
Okay, I have to specify that this input-output handling is has been designed in general to be able to handle or create automatically create the input for all the different materials. But actually, we have not yet modified, for example, the error handling, other features that are specific for the different codes. So up to now, it's everything is designed for WASP, and a further step in addition to the input generation should be carried out to make the workflow working in connection with Quantum Espresso, for example. But this is something that we would very much like to do because for example, I'm using more Quantum Espresso than WASP. So there are users that are more familiar, for example, with Quantum Espresso. So we would really like to extend the work. But this is possible. It's already designed in a very general way. But some, especially for the error handling and specific features, should be still, there is still some effort to.
For sure, but I think like just designing it in a way that it can be adapted is already like goes very far and makes it much easier. So I see a raised hand from Martina. Please, Martina.
Hello, hi Clelia, thanks for the
Ciao Martina.
talk. Nice seeing you. Actually, the answer to that question kind of answered a little bit to what I was going to ask, but I'll ask it anyway. I was wondering if you're planning to couple to this workflow tools to do the machine learning analysis directly on the data set that you produce.
I mean, to implement algorithms such as the algorithm that I presented,
Like CISO, but that handles the
that is
data.
something that we hadn't planned yet, but of course could be very a very good idea because for example, this algorithm is available, so it's a Python code that can be included in our software that is based on Python. So this is something that we have not planned yet, but you are right, it could be very nice to have the final, not
Yeah.
just the database, but also the database analysis performed automatically. Yeah.
Cool.
So maybe connecting to that, I can also say that it's of course really nice that we had last week, or not last week, but the last time we had Luca talking about CISO, and now we immediately see the application to a tribological problem, which is great, I think. And maybe in the same vein, I mean, you mentioned that it's like a lot of care has been taken to populate these databases, make them easily searchable, and so on. I think that is probably more like gives you all the tool already to then post-process this data without having to integrate everything in one complex workflow. And yeah, but I wanted to ask because the descriptors, I mean, you talked previously, and since we worked together, I'm very familiar with this about the charge density redistribution, but this was not used as a descriptor, right? In your, I mean,
On purpose,
on
because
purpose,
if
because
you use it, the
it's from the
correlation
interface,
goes
right?
very high, almost increases more than the values that I show. But we wanted to predict the adhesion just on the basis of the bulk properties or the surface energy of the two elemental metals. Properties that can be measured, can be found in the experiments. So this is the added value, because the charge displacement, of course, correlates very well. But it's something that, it's already an interfacial property, not a single, and it's also not directly measurable by experiment, as far as I know. So that was done on purpose. But
I just wanted to basically know if you looked at it, if you checked it out, if it would be a good correlation. But of course, I mean, I completely understand if you want to reduce the computational workload. I mean, if you calculate the charge density redistribution, you calculate the adhesion at the same time, so you don't gain any, let's say, computational advantage at least. Okay. So, do we have any more questions in the chat or in the panel? I don't think so.
Not from YouTube.
So then maybe we can already introduce